Good morning. A warm welcome is extended to all, especially those who are worshiping for the first time with us at GKI Gading Indah in Jakarta, Indonesia. Your presence enriches us of this time of celebration together. Today we are celebrating the 8th Sunday after Pentecost with a full worship service. This is an online service because we are trying to avoid creating a crowd of maybe prone to COVID-19. We welcome your suggestion about this program. Please send your comments at this email below. We gather around the table of God. We gather around the presence of our God. That death and sin no longer stand in the way of our life with you. Lead us, God, into all these places where we may have the joy of feeling of emptiness of others with your goodness. Amen.
Lord God Almighty, Unlike ours, God's anger does not last. But God's favor, God's grace, and God's forgiveness are for us, not just in this moment, but forever. How can we not want to confess to such a one who is ready to heal us?
Now let us pray. Compassionate God, we are so busy looking for the miracles we desire. We cannot see the gift of your presence in others. We are so intent on indulging our appetites. We have no time to look in the mirror and see our secret faces. Forgive us, steadfast love. Grace us with your mercy, so we might be made whole. Amen.
In every moment, God seeks what is best for us. God does not reject us when we do not trust fully. God continues to love us, to forgive us, and to restore us. Thanks to be God. Amen.
Stronger than death, your words are spirit. us pray. Our Father in heaven, silence all voices within our minds but your own. Help us to see and be able to follow your will in our life. May our prayers be joined with those of our sister and brothers in the faith, that together we may glorify your name and enjoy your fellowship forever. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Hear the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Luke chapter 12, verse 13 until 21. The gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Luke chapter 12, verse 13 until 21. Someone in the crowd said to him, "Teacher, tell my brother to divide the inheritance with me." Jesus replied, "Man, who appointed me a judge or an arbiter between you?" Then he said to them, "Watch out. Be on your guard against all kinds of greed. Life doesn't consist in an abundance of possessions." And he told them this parable. The ground of a certain rich man yield an abundant harvest. He thought to himself, "What shall I do? I have no place to store my crops." Then he said, "This is what I'll do. I will tear down my barns and build bigger ones, and there I will store my surplus grain. And I'll say to myself, 'You have plenty of grain laid up for many years. Take life easy. Eat, drink, and be merry.'" But God said to him, "You fool, this very night your life will be demanded from you. Then who will get what you have prepared for yourself? This is how it will be with whoever store up things for themselves, but is not rich toward God." This is the gospel of the Lord. Sister and brothers, a wise pastor once told me, "Interruption is where true ministry begins." And he went on to explain that it is in the interruption to our daily routine that God breaks in with reminders that we are here to do work. To do the work of the kingdom is far more important than our daily to-do list. So in our gospel today, we see in the middle of Jesus' daily routines of teaching, interrupted by someone who has apparently not even been listening to what Jesus has been saying. Jesus has been teaching his disciple about the need for faithfulness when he is suddenly interrupted by a person from the crowd who demand assistance. Also, it wouldn't have been unusual for someone who needed to resolve a legal matter to appeal to a local rabbi for help. Law and religion were so closely intertwined that was no different between a judge and a teacher. If this was a young man whose older brother had refused to share the father's inheritance, he might have seen Jesus as who would have the legal authority to solve his problem. On the other hand, it might be that this young man has behaving selfishly, rebelling against an older brother who was trying to keep the family together by keeping the property together. We don't know. But Jesus, in our gospel today, saw into this young man's heart and knew immediately that the man's concern was not the real problem. The real problem was greed. I'm sure the young man was surprised when Jesus refused to help him. He might be thing wasn't this the same guy who had worked miracles everywhere he went. If he could make blind people see, didn't he have the authority to do a simple thing, like forcing all the brothers to do what the law said he should do with their father's property? Instead of helping why does he talk about greed? Greed is nothing more than a desire to have more than we have. And Jesus used this moment to explain why greed has no place in the kingdom of God. So the parable of the rich fool reminds us that the debt brings an end even to a successful asset. We may get it, but we can't take it with us. If we focus our life on getting rich for ourselves, we will be missed out on a meaningful life. So at this point, we know that Jesus wasn't saying that there is anything wrong with wealth. Jesus was saying this instead of foolishly focusing our effort on getting rich for ourselves, be rich for God. I ever read an article that was titled Possessed by Money. This article described the psychological effect of wealth. And this research found that people who are minded about money are really good at pursuing goals, but they are not that interpersonally kind and warm to other people, since they see other people as rivals and isolated themselves from others. No wonder Jesus calls the rich farmer a fool. By focusing on his possession, he has isolated himself from others. And this is not what the kingdom of God is about. The kingdom of God is about community. It's about interconnectedness, living and working together for the glory of God. So how can we be rich toward God? Being rich, our God, means placing value on the same things God values. It means loving the Lord your God with all your heart, and with all your soul, and with all your mind, and with all your strength, and your neighbor as yourself. Then we can see other people not as rivals, obstacle to the justification of our desire, but instead as sister and brothers who share this world with us and enrich our life by their assistance. Rather than live in this satisfaction, we can practice a sense of wonder. Rather than be distracted from relationship, we can sever them. Instead of storing away possession, we can realize that kingdom of God is ours to enjoy now and hereafter. Amen.
Let us confess the faith into which we were baptized according to the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the powers of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of the saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for those who have devoted themselves to intercession for others. We pray that you give them knowledge of your will and that they will pray accordingly. Give them spiritual wisdom and understanding, make their prayer fruitful. We also pray that we can soon return to our normal worship. We want going back to meet each other together, worship you. And Lord God, help us to remember those who tonight will go to sleep unfed and unwelcome strangers in foreign lands, people who have fled for their lives and far from their homes, so many people carrying wounds, mental and physical. So many have suffered greatly. Jesus, give us hope of your compassion for their plight. Soften our hearts to their situation and help us follow your lead in seeking justice and mercy on their behalf. We give thanks that your blessing can bring life, dignity, and hope to those that remain. We thank you that you are Lord of all the earth and all its people are loved by you. We pray this thing in the name of Jesus, who teach us the Lord's Prayer. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
Let us continue our worship by bringing our offering to God, while remembering what Paul says. Each of you should give what you have decided in your heart to give, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verses 7. Offering of our gifts, as well as the living of our days, may we not grow weary of doing what is right, but commit to speaking up for the voiceless, healing the broken, feeding the hungry, and all those mercies which are such a part of your heart and hopes for all your children. In the Jesus name we pray. Amen.
Thank you.
the world in peace. Have courage. Hope unto what is good. Return no one evil for evil. Strengthen the faint-hearted. Support the weak. Help the suffering. Honor all persons. Honor all creation. Love and serve the Lord, rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit. And may the love of God, the life of Christ, and the power and communion of the Holy Spirit be with us all. Go in peace. Amen.